Good deal, good deal. Grab your Bibles, grab your notes, grab a pen. Let's get ready to roll. In the first service, a former pastor of Community Bible Church named Scott, some of you remember Pastor Scott. He was youth minister here for a number of years, and he was sitting right over here. And it's good to see him, good to see him. But drove all the way in from Daytona Beach, where he now pastors a church, but he drove in from Daytona Beach to go to the game today. He's a Green Bay fan. Which is why he's no longer a pastor here. But I said to him, I said, seriously, man, you left your congregation to come to a game. I said, God cannot honor that. God will not honor that, which is good for us, right? No, this pastor here would not do such a thing. But we might get out a little early today. If you write fast, okay? Take quick notes. We're going to move through this. It's part of what we call the Daniel Plan. How many of you have been with us since the start of the Daniel Plan, beginning of this year? Yeah, that's awesome. Good deal. And those of you who have jumped in and you're part of the Daniel Plan, you're already finding out that it's really not so much about food. It's more about glorifying God with your body. That's what it really is all about. And so people are making choices and decisions to be healthy so that we can go on and fulfill the purposes that God has called us to here in 2017. We continue on with the same today. Today we're talking about goals that God blesses. And I got to tell you guys this week, man, I have heard it time and time again. People just come up to me, even in the store, even at Walmart, right out of the blue, they'll walk up to me and they'll look at me and say, I think it's our year. And I say, yeah, I think it's our year. I think it's our year. And obviously, you know what they're talking about. I know what they're talking about. But let me ask you this morning. Could this be your year? Could this be your year? The year that everything changes. The year that choices are made, that decisions are made, that goals are set. And the year that you finally see those goals fulfilled, different from the other years. Different from those past years where maybe you'd make a resolution, or maybe you'd have a wish or even a dream. But another year passes by and nothing happens. It's all missed. But could this be the year? Your year. The year that God says, I want you to make some goals. And not only do I want you to make those goals, I want to bless you in those goals. Do you know that God wants to bless you? Do you believe that God really wants to bless you? Let me tell you real quick. In the Old Testament, we find something very, very interesting where God commanded the priest each morning to go out and pray a blessing over the children of Israel. It was called the priestly blessing. And that's exactly what would happen where the priest would go out and he'd hold his hands up like this over the people of Israel and he would say these words, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord shine his face on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Does that not surprise you or shock you that God is saying, I want to bless you. I want to bless you so much I'm commanding my priest to pray this blessing over you each and every day. Can you imagine the impact that had when people heard the priest praying the blessing of God on them? You know, he does the same thing with you today. Our great high priest, Jesus himself. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord bless you. Can you believe for a moment that God really does want to bless you this year? Can you take that? Can you own that? Can you walk in that? Because if you can, it's going to change everything. It makes all the difference in the world. It really does. Father, I pray this morning that I can step out of the way and you would speak and you would speak to our hearts. And in your speaking to our hearts, you would change our hearts. Not leaving us as we were, but instead calling out something in us. Not allowing us to be people who simply sit on the sidelines, but calling us into the game of what you called us to be and what you've called us to do. Let this year be different. Where we know that you indeed do want to bless us, and we choose to make goals that honor and glorify and please you, goals that will be blessed by you. And let us get to the end of this year able to look back and saying, wow, look what God did, and rejoice and celebrate because of you. We ask that you'll move now here in this place. Have your way with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Apostle Paul writes in Philippians, and I want you to notice, this is a verse that we've been talking about for a few weeks now, but it says this, "No, dear brothers and sisters, I have not achieved it, but I focus. I focus on this one thing, forgetting the past," and some of you remember a couple weeks ago, we all waved goodbye to 2016, right? "Forgetting the past, but looking forward to what lies ahead," he says, "I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us." Maybe in this verse you see the focus. Maybe in this verse you see that there are these goals, that there is a prize that he's shooting for, that he's not wandering aimlessly about on the planet. He's here for a purpose. He's here for a reason. I found that there are four different types of people in this world. Number one, there are people who make things happen. Number two, there are people who watch things happen. Number three, there are people who've got no idea what's happening. And number four, especially in this age of social media, there are people who live their life criticizing those who make things happen. Which one will you be? Which one of those people will you be in 2017? Will you wander aimlessly? Or will you set goals that need to be achieved in your life? Zig Ziglar put it best. He said, if you aim at nothing, you're sure to always hit that. Nothing. Let us not be those people. Instead, let's set those goals, what we call godly goals. And watch how God wants to bless us in 2017. Real quick, put your hand up like this. All right, this is your homework. This is going to be your homework. Keep your hand up. This is going to be your homework. As soon as you leave here today, you're going to start with five. That's my challenge to you. Five high goals. Your high five goals. And there's some stipulations here, okay? And we're going to go through these things. But these five goals, I want to challenge you to write down. Not only write them down, I want you to pray about them. And I want you to share them, maybe with the person next to you. If it's the person next to you in your family that will hold you accountable, give them a high five real quick, okay? Good. But that's going to be your homework. The high five for 2017. But here we go. I'm going to give you this morning, I'm going to give it rather quickly, so pay attention, write fast. For no reason in particular. Godly goals, five of them, the kind that he blesses. And the first one is this, number one, write it down. Godly goals, the kind that he blesses, number one, they bring glory to God. That's the first stipulation, that's the most important one. That any goal that I write down, it must bring glory to God. It must really be all about him and for his praise and for his honor. That's the first stipulation in our godly goals, the kind that he blesses. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, what does it say? So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, I want you to circle those three words, whatever you do. Could he possibly mean, really, whatever you do? Oh, come on, Pastor. Surely he doesn't mean in some of the menial things, some of the mundane things, some of the simple things that I do. No, it says right here, in whatever you do, if it's eating, if it's drinking, in whatever it is that you do, he says, do all for the glory of God. All of that for the glory of God. He says it here in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9. So whether we are here in this body or away from this body, our goal is to what? Please him. Please him. Even in the things that we think don't really matter. He says, choose to please him. I got this thing in the mail the other day. Came in a little box. And I opened it up and it had some directions on it. It said, step one, plug this into your car. I thought, I don't really know where to plug it in at. But it came from my insurance company, my car insurance company. And I had to go get my oil changed anyway, and I went to my buddy's place just down the road there and pulled in, and I got out, and I said, hey, listen, I got this thing from my insurance company. And what it says is that if I plug this in my car, then they might give me a discount on my auto insurance. And when I said that, he let out a big belly laugh and said, you of all people don't need this plugged into your car. I said, what are you talking about? He goes, I know the way you drive. He goes, do you understand what this thing is? I said, well, I know it's supposed to kind of track your driving a little bit. He goes, man, this thing right here will tell them when you speed up. It'll tell them when you master the brakes too hard, a hard stop. It'll tell them everything about your driving. He goes, seriously, you really don't want me to put this in your car? I'm like, I don't know, man. What can it hurt if I, put it in there? Maybe I'll get a discount. If not, I'll just change insurance companies or something like that. I don't know, man. Maybe that's what I'll do. And so he plugged it in for me, and I got in the car, and I drove away, and that little thing is all lit up, And it's just lit up, and I'm noticing it down there, and I'm starting to really think to myself, uh-oh, what have I done? But the amazing thing about it, I don't know who it's talking to. It's sending it somewhere, some all these little messages out there somewhere, These little, I'll do something, just sends a message, and somebody somewhere is getting these little signals about my driving, like, Pastor Bo, you drive too fast. but you know what happened this week is the strangest thing. You guys know about me, and you know about my driving, but this past week, I was a good driver. Oh, my goodness, I was. I found myself, and when I'd start to speed up, uh-oh, can't be doing that. And I'd slow down. I was checking the speed limits on all the roads I was at. I was maintaining the speed limit right there. And when I turn, I put my blinker on. I would stop at stop signs. I'm driving like Granny Bo, okay? What really changed in my life? Do you see my motivation? Do you see what happened? You see, before my motivation might have been, I got to get there fast, got to get there quick. Don't want to sit in traffic, don't want to do this, don't want to wait too long. My motivation suddenly changed when it became about, I might save some money. And knowing that changed the way I lived, how I acted, how I behaved. Yeah, there's a truth in that, guys. There's a truth in that. You see, when you realize that he is with you everywhere, that there, David said, man, there's nowhere I can go to get away from your presence. Nowhere at all I can go to get away from your presence. And when we believe that, when we realize that, it changes everything about us, that no matter where I am and whatever I do, I can choose to do it all for the glory of God. And that makes all the difference in the world. Even something that before I didn't enjoy doing or didn't like to do, a menial task, a meaningless task. Let me ask, how many of you love to take out the garbage? Yeah, that's what I thought. Nobody. Are you crazy? Nobody wants to take out the garbage, man. The garbage, it stinks, man. Nobody likes to take out the garbage. You just don't want to take out the garbage. I hate to take out the garbage. I don't like to take out the garbage. But wait a second. It says, in whatever you do, maybe, just maybe, I can make a choice that the next time I take out the garbage, I'm going to take that time that it takes me to walk down to the street to put it in the garbage can and back, then I'm going to start to thank God. I'm going to thank Him in that moment. I'm going to thank Him that I actually have garbage to be able to be taken out. I'm going to thank Him that I have garbage, because if I didn't have garbage, that would mean I didn't have anything in the first place to make garbage from. And He blessed me so much that I do have a lot of garbage. And so taking out the garbage suddenly has meaning and purpose. It meaning and purpose in life, and it makes all the difference in the world. Those of you parents, you're going to know exactly what I'm talking about right here. How many of you have had kids, your kids, look at you and say, I am so bored? Huh? Happens all the time, right? Right? Does, right? But you know what? I've realized something. There's just as many of us adults going through life saying, I am so bored. And you know what that translates as? You know what that it translates? I have no meaning and purpose in life. I have no meaning and purpose in life. What's my life really all about? No meaning, purpose, no satisfaction. None. That's what that means. But do you realize that that's a choice? It's not something that's just put on you and just happened to you. That's a choice. That's a choice because this says right here that it's a choice. That no matter what I do, whether it's eating or drinking or in that job that I didn't think had any real purpose or meaning in life, in whatever I do, I can choose to glorify God. If I make the choice to glorify God, even in the most mundane, menial things in life, we suddenly realize that He changes everything, and the most mundane, even menial task in life can suddenly become a source of incredible satisfaction and joy throughout my life. But it's all a choice as to whether or not I choose to worship Him in whatever I do. Godly goal number one, it's got to be about praising, glorifying, bringing glory to God. Godly goal number two, the kind that He blesses. Number two, they're motivated by love. Motivated by love. Let me just pause right here for a second, and as soon as you finish writing that down, look up at me, okay? I want to ask you a question. I want you to think hard about it. Over this past week, what has been your primary motivation? What's your go-to motivation in life? What is the one that you always kind of rely on? It's become your best friend, maybe. All right, here are a few ideas, a few suggestions. For some people, their big motivation in life is guilt. And I don't know where it started. It might have been your parent always put a guilt trip on you and taught you well how to feel guilty all the time. And you got older and they're not there anymore, so you just kind of carried on that process yourself. And so now every day you kind of pack your guilt bags and set out on a guilt trip. And that has become your motivation in life. But the problem with that, it's kind of a sick motivation. It's not at all a godly motivation. God's not going to bless that goal that is motivated by guilt. In fact, Scripture says that because of what Christ did, He has come. David said this, he goes, you have removed the guilt of my sins from me. And so that's not the motivation. That's a motivation that dies quick. That's a motivation that doesn't last long, if that's the one. Or how about this? Maybe it's not guilt for you. Maybe your motivation is a common one. A lot of people might have this, is the motivation of jealousy or envy. And so your go-to throughout the week is constantly comparing yourself with all those people around you. And in your mind, deep down, you're going, well, I don't have what they have, and it makes me upset that I don't have what they have, and so I'm going to fight to get what I have and have more than they have. If I can beat them somehow, or I don't look like her, or I don't have the friends they have, And there's this constant comparison and battle going on inside of you, and it really is the motivation of jealousy and envy, and it produces all sorts of sickness inside of us if we allow that to go on. It's a terrible motivation. It'll ruin you, it'll destroy you. Maybe it's not that. Maybe it's the motivation of peer pressure. Peer pressure, it's I want to be sure that I'm accepted. I want to be accepted by those people around me, and whatever they tell me to do, they can suggest this or say this, and I just want to be accepted so desperately, so bad, that my big motivation in life is peer pressure. How many of you remember when you were a kid and your mom said, if everybody jumped off a cliff, would you? Remember that? And at that time, you're like, well, yeah, of course, because there's nothing worse than not being accepted. And so many of us, we still live that out today. And it's that peer pressure motivation. But that too is a sick motivation. What if your motivation today suddenly became the motivation of love? Now that's the real motivation. That's the motivation that God himself had when he went to the cross for you and I. He did it out of love. That's the motivation that a parent knows when that child comes, that motivation. They know it, and they know it so well. Let me ask real quick. How many of you parents would you love your kids? Okay, one step further. How many parents love your kids so much that you would die for your kids? Yeah, absolutely. Now, here's one more question. How many of you parents love your kids so much that you'd be willing to live for them? You see where we're going with that? I know so many parents who say, I love my kids, I'd be willing to die for them. Nevertheless, they can't say, I love my kids so much, I want to be able to live a little bit longer so I can be here with them another day, and so therefore I'm going to make choices and decisions that don't kill me early. These two rows right here. I have had so many funerals where I've stood up here and I've grieved with the people on these front two rows. So many funerals, man. And I've cried with them, I've wept with them, I've been through, and where they have lost that loved one. And I guarantee you, if I asked any one of them at any time, they would say, I just wish I had a little more time. And so maybe that becomes the motivation that I love my kids, and so I want to be able to give my best to my kids. And so there are choices that I have to make that honor and please God. It's the love motivation. I love my spouse. I love my wife. I love my husband. So therefore, I'm going to make choices that I know they might not be easy to make. They might be difficult ones at times, but I'm willing to do that because I got the love motivation. The love motivation says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. The love motivation, I have seen moves people in amazing ways. I've watched people come to life with the love motivation here at this church. When suddenly they see somebody out there that they can serve, and maybe they go to Nicaragua, and they see the kids there, and they start to serve the kids, and they just come alive because they've got that love motivation. I've seen God just move through people in an amazing way when that love motivation kicks in. And when you set a goal with the love motivation, that's a goal that God likes to bless. Godly goals, the kind that he blesses, number one, bring glory to God. Number two, are motivated by love. Number three, fulfill one of God's purposes for your life. Godly goals, the kind that he blesses, they fulfill one of God's purposes for your life. 1 Corinthians 9:26, Paul says it this way, so I run with every purpose in every step. I run with every purpose, with purpose in every step. In other words, that's saying how he lives day after day after day. He's not wandering aimlessly. There's purpose and there's meaning in his life, why he does what he does. It's the love motivation, and it's moving him to fulfill those purposes that God has called us to. What are those purposes? Well, here's the secret. It's really not about you, and it's not about me. It's not about us. It's all about God. And God has designed you, God has shaped you, God has made you as the creator of the universe for these purposes. The highest, the first, number one, is to worship him. Another purpose is to get to know him and grow in him, in that relationship with him. Another purpose is to share him with as many people as you can. Another purpose is to minister to people in his name. Another purpose is to get to know those around you who worship him, fellowship with the other believers. Those purposes, and that's what God calls you to do. And when you're in those purposes, you're running with purpose in every step. If I said Team Hoyt, I wonder if you would know who I'm talking about. Team Hoyt. You probably don't know the name, but I bet you know the story. I bet you've probably seen the photos, too. Team Hoyt is a father-son team, and what do? They run Ironman triathlons. The reason I know you've probably seen the picture is the father has a son who has cerebral palsy. But he realized that his son always lit up and got excited at the chance of being in a race. And so he set out to train and to prepare himself and to run a race with his son, designed a wheelchair made just for that. They've run Ironman triathlon after triathlon after triathlon. And the way it happens is the dad gets into the water and he straps something to him that's tied to a boat with his son in the boat, and the father swims. And then when he's done swimming, he gets out and he gets on the bike and he puts his son in this basket in the front of his bike and he bikes all those miles. And then when he's done with that, he gets out and he puts his son in this wheelchair and he runs 26.2 miles for that boy who gets excited about being in races. What's his motivation? Love. And he runs with purpose in every step. Runs with purpose in every step. Oh, man, that you would run with purpose in every step. That love motivation would grab you, that you would see where God's taking you to and what he wants to fulfill through you, that you would catch a glimpse of that purpose and it would change everything. Every time I read this verse, I don't know about you, it says, so I run with purpose in every step. I can't help but think of the greatest movie that was ever made. Rocky. Come on now. Rocky, every step. Yeah, you remember the steps, right? You remember all those steps. He'd run up, he's out there, and he's training, and he'd run through, and finally runs to the top of the steps. He's running purpose every step. He gets to the top, and he's just dancing around like that, right? Remember that? And then he gets to the end of the movie. The goal and the purpose, what he's been working for so long, and he gets out there, and man, he is taking a beating, isn't he? He gets knocked down, but he gets up. He gets knocked down, but he gets up. He gets knocked down, but he gets up. And he makes it through the fight. Nobody thought it happened, man. They thought I just spit a lot. I'm so sorry right there, man. Nobody thought it would happen, but it happened. And there is the end of the movie. And he's all bloody. And I just can't see out of this eye. But you remember the scene. He puts his arm like this. And he's yeah. You remember? Remembering something inside you, like, Adrian. I want you to have that yo, Adrian moment. You're running with purpose, and it's not always going to be easy. It's going to be difficult and tough. How many of you remember those days when your parents used to say to you, life's not fair? It's not, is it? It's a battle, and it's tough, and it's difficult, but that day is coming, and you're going to be, Adrian. Having accomplished those goals because you're being blessed by God. Godly goals, the kind that he blesses, number one, bring glory to God. Number two, are motivated by love. Number three, fulfill one of God's purposes for your life. Number four, they're set in faith. They're set in faith. What does it mean to be set in faith? When you write a goal, do you write a little bitty goal? One that you know, oh man, I can get this done next week. Or do you write a big goal? Do you write I've discovered people write goals in proportion to their faith. People write goals in proportion to their faith. People who write little tiny goals, they don't want to be disappointed in life. Little tiny goals, And so often you can match that with their concept of God, little tiny God. God, don't want to put too much on you. No, you can't handle much. It's too much. That's a big one. I got this one, okay? You lay out. Don't need you. But what if you wrote a goal down and you said, there is no way in this world that I can do this. God, I need you. God, I need you. Oh, God, I need you. A goal that stretches you, a goal that scares you, a goal that causes you to turn to Him, and that's so what He wants you to do, to turn to Him and say, I need you to bless me. Without you, got nothing. The kind of goal that God blesses. Godly goals, the kind that He blesses, they bring glory to God, number one. Number two, are motivated by love. Number three, fulfill one of God's purposes for your life. Number four, they're set in faith. And finally, number five, are achieved with God's power. Are achieved with God's power. Zechariah 4:6, it's not by force nor by strength, but by my Spirit, says the Lord of Heaven's armies. I remember being in the car driving over by my parents to some people's house. I was just a kid. They wanted us to go eat dinner with them. So we went over there, and I didn't know what to expect. I was a little guy, young kid. Got out of the car and started getting introduced to the family, and that's when I met their two teenage sons, Bobby and Brad. I was kind of a bit enamored with these teenage boys, not only because they were teenagers and I was just a little kid, but also because Bobby was just shy of 7 feet tall. He's a basketball player. And I remember we get out and we got a little time before dinner is going to be served, and Bobby says, hey, how about we play a little two-on-two basketball? You see, one of Brad's friends from the neighborhood came over, and two-on-two basketball? Seriously? I'm just a little guy. How could I ever play in a game with you guys? But nevertheless, Bobby looks at me and goes, Bo, I want you to be on my team. He picked me. He picked me. And so I got out there with Bobby, and it was against his little brother Brad and the friend that came over. And next thing I know, Bobby throws the basketball over to me. I said, take the ball. And I start to dribble around. Don't really know much of what I'm doing. I'm dribbling around. And next thing you know, I decided, I'm going to take a shot. I'm not even strong enough to shoot like this. So I take the ball, and I'm like... You know what happened next, though? Old 7-foot Bob standing under the basket reaches up from wherever it was my ball went, grabs it with one hand, brings it around, and slam dunks it. That's what we just did. I'll have you know, we went on to win that game. And I say, we went on to win that game. I know what you're thinking. Little Bo and Big Bob. Little Bo didn't do so much. Big Bob did it all, but that's okay. That's okay, because we still won. We still won. You know, I told you, come up with five big ones, okay? Five. But you're going to find in 2017, the best that you can do is take those five and continually go, God, you take it. I can't do it without you. I need you. But I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. ...2017, this is your year. Let's pray. It begins with a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, friends. If you don't have that, call out to Him, please, right here, right now. Understanding just how desperately you need Him. You cannot save yourself. It's your sin that separates you from God. But God loves you so much, he sent his son Jesus, who died on the cross for you in your place, taking all your sin, my sin, on himself. And so right here, right now, you can call out to him and say, Jesus, save me. I need you in my life. Please forgive me. Come into my life and be my God and my Savior, my friend. When you pray that prayer, you mean it with your heart. The Bible says you can know you have eternal life. Best decision you'll ever make. And the rest is simply continually, each and every day, calling out to him, I want my life to glorify you, God. Lead me, guide me, shape me, make me to be the person you want me to be. Thank you, Father, for loving us in that way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right.